favorite one.
And with that, folks, we're into game two in our set between FTD and Team Fantuan. Once again, this is Stall Ladder I-League China series. We're going to be seeing who's making it to the Stall Ladder LAN Finals, which you just all heard so much about. So I hope you're as excited as I am to see these two teams compete. And I'm really hoping we have a bit more of an even game. Let's head right into the draft then. So, Noble Wings, what do you think they need to do differently on FTD?
I think they need a draft a little more stable, maybe something that can win their lanes consistently without relying on ganks. Just strong laners in general that they can snowball Roshan's off of since they're on Dire's side.
Yeah, and I think that's just a very sensible thing. They've managed to get the Tusk, who's made it through because they banned out the Shadow Fiend. And I think this can set them up for something really nice. We saw the Bounty Hunter having a lot of trouble making ganks connect. I think the Tusk is a much easier hero to gank with overall.
Yeah, there's a reason Tusk is at 100% pick ban rate. He's like I said earlier, I think today, he's good at everything. He can gank, he can save people, he can do a lot of damage. He's a really good all-around hero, somewhat like Queen of Pain.
Now, I also find this opening really interesting by FTD. Obviously, the Queen of Pain, we've talked about her. She's fantastic right now. She's a great hero. And we've seen the Spirit Breaker very popular in this meta, but A plus Tusk, that generally does mean you're going to hit that Cold Feet either by using the Snowball or the Ice Shards to just force them to pulse around it, and this Cold Feet will proc. That's obviously fantastic for a team. Do you think this makes it an offlane or a support Tusk? Because you could certainly have these two, I think, roam as a combo even.
I think it will be offlane. I don't know if they want to run support Tusk, because it does limit their lockdown, because as a support Tusk, although you can gank and maybe get a stun with Ancient Aberration, you can't really kill the Quat mid, you can't really roam that well on their safe lane. You are a melee hero. I feel like he's better suited to an offlane, maybe a dual offlane. Undying is still in the pool, and there's, Undying is still in the pool. So there are options like that.
Yeah, so we're going to be having Nightstalker banned out, and the Bounty Hunter. I guess FTD really valuing this over the lineup of Fantuan. I don't know if they were that worried, you know, or planning on picking it up. And Gyrocopter banned out, so they have gotten themselves a nice Undying pick. How fantastic.
I think that was more of a block pick for me. I don't know if it's necessarily great for them, but it does kind of block the Tusk Undying lane that's really difficult to deal with any sort of tri-lane.
Yeah. So, I think it's really nice here as well. You can run the Undying Spirit Breaker lane. It's, yeah. But Fantuan, suddenly, scary lane for them. They have a scary lane. FTD, you need to pick a carry that can stand up to a lot. And Templar Assassin, an interesting choice here, considering that there's a Quap and Undying on the field.
Yeah, he's not great versus them, but there are a couple pros to picking him up. He's really good on Dire, as he has the Roshan advantage. Ancients are a little easier to stack and to take on Dire for TA especially, as he's able to get the side blades through him as you bring him up the high ground on Dire's side. He's also pretty good versus Quap. A lot of people think Quap Vex the matchup, but as long as you use your tangos effectively and keep sentries in lane, it's a winnable matchup because you can just dodge Shadow Strike with your meld, as long as you make sure that you're the one that has the sentry game won.
Yeah, very true. So, we're gonna be... See, that wasn't who I was expecting, but I like it a lot. I feel like Batrider is really strong, has been kind of ignored here. I know there are a number of teams in the scene who do feel like Batrider is a good counter to someone like an SF, and I feel like he's also a nice... He has lots of ways to deal with a Templar. You can't exactly just kind of meld and hope and pray against a Batrider, because he's just going to Firefly on your face.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see maybe that they even put the Batrider mid and run the Quap on offlane, or maybe something like that, and run the Spirit Breaker and Undying and maybe support positions. They could do a lot with this draft, as all their heroes are very open. You can run Queen of Pain in pretty much any lane, you can run Spirit Breaker in any lane, same thing with Undying and Batrider.
Yeah, I actually really like it. I would be really interested to see The Batrider. Oh, I would really prefer to see the Batrider mid. I feel like that's a great way of shutting down a Templar Assassin. She already has the range disadvantage just because of how Psyblades work. And then, of course, Batrider, you get maybe four stacks up on someone and you win. And they pick an Ember Spirit into that.
This is a risky draft.
I feel like this
Again,
is a
I think.
really rough Ember game. Maybe I'm confused on something, but you've got Netherstrike, you've got Lasu, you've got Queen of Pain who can go for an Orchid. You try to maybe do a team fight and there's a Tombstone down, which you're not maybe the best. Although you will get, if you can get a lot of items, you'll get more cleaves off of all the zombies, but
5 seconds
like,
remaining.
what are the odds?
And even if you're cleaving off zombies, I don't know if that's what you want to be doing in the fight.
5 seconds
Yeah.
remaining.
It's interesting. It does have lockdown, which I like, and I felt they needed more lockdown. It does build a Lincoln Sphere, which is going to be useful. It will have some issues dealing with the Queen of Pain going into the mid game if she gets Orchid up, but as long as they can stay ahead in the game, I think they're going to be fine. He's good at anti-push, so even if Undying tries to
5
5-man and they
seconds
try to
remaining.
5-man at you during Tick Towers, if they get maybe a last pick, something that can push really
Reserve
effectively,
retired.
Ember Spirit will be really useful. It's not a bad pick, it's just not the greatest pick.
Yeah. And as an Ember Spirit, I don't feel like you often want to be buying a Lincoln's if you can help it. It just delays you getting up your damage items.
Yeah, it's not a great item, but luckily you can still get it after your Battle Fury and farm it pretty fast and then move straight into a crit.
So. For the Bane ban out, I think is really interesting. I think they're just worried about Quap lockdown and maybe deciding that they don't think they can support it.
They
Needing me to.
also don't have a fantastic amount of ways to cancel Fiend's Grip. They have Lasso. They have Spirit Breaker ulti, but you don't really want to use those to cancel Bane. And then you only have Charge and Flame Break left, so you don't really have too many ways to cancel his Fiend's Grip.
And it's kind of funny because both teams need picking and banning out the same types of heroes. They both now need a support, or they need a hero that has good lockdown for the mobile heroes, Quap and Ember Spirit on both sides.
I was thinking actually that, because right now Queen of Pain and Batrider, or I thought they were going to go for a carry, but it looks like they went
Dire
for a
team ping.
Viper mid.
I actually like this a lot. Viper is fantastic against Ember for a number of reasons, but a lot of people kind of forget that heroes that slow an Ember, while of course it's not as good as lockdown, but if you have to use those remnants maybe to defensively get away, one Viper Strike, you don't care if you expend that and make Ember waste his remnant every time. Like, that's no cost to you as a Viper.
10 seconds
Also, for the Ember Spirit, if
remaining.
he's in a team fight and he takes any of the Viper slow, suddenly the remnants he's using to escape are also slowed. But they go with Broodmother. And into a Batrider, I'm not a Broodmother expert. How do you feel about this?
I don't think this is the Broodmother game. There's a Spirit Breaker, there's an Undying, there's a Batrider, as you pointed out. Those are all genuinely good heroes versus Broodmother. But the thing is that Team FT's lineup is really, like, really risky. It can't go past maybe 30 minutes. I mean, Undying falls off really hard, Spirit Breaker falls off, Viper, like, super falls off past 30 minutes. So does Queen of Pain to an extent. So the only real useful hero they have for the late game is Batrider, and that's just because of his lasso being such a strong spell.
Also,
And
with that Ags
if.
upgrade, which we might
Oh,
see.
yeah,
5 seconds
absolutely.
remaining.
But if FTD Club can just stall the game out with Brood Split Push and Ember High Ground for maybe 30 minutes, I think this game's in the bag.
Yeah. And with that, we're in, folks. So let's go do our delightful
Prepare for
introductions,
battle.
interruptions, folks, that we always have going on. We've got. I can't remember which team I did, but I'm gonna try to do FTD. We've got Xion on. Yeah, that actually is now Xion on Broodmother. We've got Ember Spirit being played up by Monet, and this is actually the team I introduced last time, so oh well, we'll keep going with it. Eyuan on Ancient Apparition. Templar Assassin played by QCC, the pause that happens every game coming out. And the fellow with the Chinese characters, one of which I think is Person, but probably is not. Chillaxin on that Tusk.
Okay, going on the Radiant side, we have Paparazzi going on the Queen of Pain. We have Pretty Hawk playing the Undying. We have ZSMJ taking the Viper, going down the middle lane this game. We have DDR playing up the Spirit Breaker, and we have finally in July playing on that Batrider.
I'm excited to see this. He's gone boots first. He's got a sentry. Broodmother is, I think, in for a bad party. It's like, I don't know what word to say there. She's in for a bad time. Let's just put it that way.
Broodmother's a
A hero.
it's a hero in Dota. Yeah, you
Yeah,
know.
I feel like
It's a fun hero.
she's a great pick when you know the other team maybe doesn't have lockdown or heroes. When they have weak supports who can't really respond to your wave clear at all. And here, I mean, both Spirit Breaker can just charge away from you and not care. The Undying, not the weakest, and has things like Soul Rip, which can really punish you. Of course, then you've got Queen of Pain and Batrider with easy ways to clear you. And I don't know if you're killing off a Viper before his corrosive skin is like bye-bye Spiderling. So I am a little concerned, but it is also something where we've seen Broodmothers take over games, even sometimes games that maybe they shouldn't have.
Oh, absolutely. And Broodmother is kind of one of those heroes, and it's kind of what I mentioned to you earlier. He's a hero that changes the way you play the game. I think AUI said this about Tekkies, where Tekkies is a hero that like made you play differently. And Broodmother is pretty much the same way. It means you have to kind of tri lane, you have to sit your supports in your lane, it means you can't really gank mid. It really limits your options on what you can do in the game. And it changes the way you play Dota, which almost no other hero besides maybe Broodmother, Tekkies, really does.
Yeah, so I just wonder if this is the right game for her. And as we talked about, lots of different things. Now, we already mentioned the Templar Assassin, awesome advantages on the Dire team. I also think that potentially with a Roaming Tusk, we might be able to see some more stack potential coming out. Yeah, so.
Well, can Tusk stack two camps with ice shards? I don't know if it's long range enough. It
No,
could be.
I just meant more like he's actually roaming, so he might be able to
Okay.
get something done. Like it's similar to what we see with Lich, where just because he roams, sometimes we see more stacked camps up, which can help TA.
Well, I was gonna think
30
maybe
seconds to
Broodmother could
launch.
make a play where he puts kind of a web around here. I don't know if you can see my pings, but around there, and he sends one spiderling every like 50 seconds to stack that camp for
Oh.
ancients. It could be really good.
I have not, in fact, seen that play before, and I agree with you, that would be fantastic. Templar Assassin, she just so benefits from having Ancient stacked for her, and it's certainly a way where if you've got a Templar Assassin who's farmed, especially since she's wearing a really cool set, I don't
Battle
know if that helps, but
begins.
she's got a feather on her head. So, if you get
Inspiring.
her off to a great start, she can take over your games, and even if the Broodmother's maybe having a bit of a rough time, this Templar will make space.
And I don't think if well the Broodmother's gonna go up against the Undying and the Queen of Pain, where the Batrider that has the sentries is going up against a tri-lane. And oh no, this isn't good. They put all the sentries going up against the tri-lane, so the
Yeah.
lane that's going versus Broodmother doesn't have any.
One maybe headed top, the Spirit Breaker, has a sentry on him as well, but as you talked about, the sentry split not really favoring. And a nice early rotation because Broodmother definitely went down bottom. He even placed a ward. She even placed a ward. I just tend to call heroes by whatever gender pronoun is on my tongue, so that's what we're gonna have, folks. But no, she has gone top. She's now getting way more space than I expected. Now, this mid matchup. Everybody loses to a Viper, is my understanding. Is there anything Templar Assassin can do here other than maybe stack and hope?
She's definitely gonna level side blades to level 2. She just needs to make sure that if she doesn't die in this lane and she's able to stack her camps, she should be fine going into the mid game. As in, Viper doesn't really have a way to farm camps effectively. He kind of just sits in lane and does his thing, where TA can farm ancients, can catch up with jungle, and they might be going
Oh,
on top right
they
now.
are, and Xuan, he should have been able to know here. They can see you when you can't walk through the trees. You know they have vision, so unfortunately falling there, and they didn't even need the sentries in the correct lane. So Broodmother, already not off to maybe the best of starts, 2 CS and only level 2, but it's, you know, Broodmother's one of those heroes that needs a few levels, and then that's when she starts to take off. So
Yeah.
she can make a comeback.
And one thing that's surprising me is I thought Viper would be kind of dominant in this mid lane, but TA is actually ahead of Viper in CS
Yeah,
right now.
I have
He's
no
doing really
idea.
well.
I was watching Toph. What happened?
I don't know. TA is just playing really well. He got his last hits. He's using Psyblades effectively. He did go for level 2 refraction, which was a surprise to me, as I thought he would go Psyblades, but it's working out really well for him.
Yeah, and I think it's entirely possible, as you mentioned, Viper might just maybe need a few more levels to do better. Maybe
Oh,
this
there's a
TA
gank going
or
on
with
mid.
this. Yeah, and that's gonna be Refractions down. Gets a point in Meldstrike, though, and they don't have the sentries. Well played. I've seen this play before, and it can just cause so much havoc. Yeah, she may have to chill here in Meldstrike for a little bit, but once those refractions are back up, she can just pop right on out, and there is a regen rune waiting for her bottom. So a really nice job there. I would say that's totally worth it. And, like, you never know what you can do with an extra early point in Meldstrike.
Yeah, we see a lot of TAs now skip it, and kind of maybe even save the point at level 5 to maybe get it another refraction or meld if you need it. Oh
And
god.
that was the ganking combo I talked about. They went in Snowball and just, they didn't even have the Cold Feet yet. They didn't need it to proc. Just Chilling Touch, Snowball, Ice Shards, even though Batrider can Firefly over those, just too much damage coming out from that pair. And they're getting some work done on FTD.
Yeah, and Broodmother's gonna be having a fun time. He's getting his Sol Ring right now. He is starting to collect spiders. This lane gets really difficult now for the Undying and the Queen of Pain.
Yeah. And just spitting at things, having them pop into baby spiders, and dying is like, what is this? There's blood all over the ground. Not a good thing. So what's the game plan here? Let's talk game plans. We already mentioned that we think that FTD's lineup can go way later, and Brood even, oh goodness, Brood. That was a questionable play. Giving a lot of gold over suddenly to the Queen of Pain. Ignore her CS, it is full of lies, because those are all spiderlings. And a bunch more. Do you want a split? Oh, she even denies it. That's so sad. Do you want a split pushing Brood to see here? I also think Brood can definitely build into a fighting Brood lineup, but I don't know if that's what they want here with an Ember Spirit. I think you just want to buy time. And about to be dusted. Gonna have to
Oh
try to
no.
walk it off. There is a charge coming. No TP support, I believe. Broodmother is gonna be slowly auto attack down. One more auto attack should do it. Yeah, I was gonna say maybe if you're really tricksy, you can deny yourself there. Unfortunately, that is a rough play. And Templar Assassin, why are there so many heroes in mid? Five all of a sudden, they get the Viper, they've got Chilling Touch for the Batman, but standing in the fire, that is not good, and nobody can turn around to auto attack him. It doesn't manage to kill off the AA with the last auto attack, but Templar Assassin, she also doesn't have refractions. They're just gonna meld strike. Chill in the dark.
Broodmother, I think, can go for either or. I guess the way I see this game playing out is that maybe at 30 minutes, FT decides that they need to start making stuff happen. They try to go for Roshan, and then they're going to try to go for a high ground push. Broodmother can either go for a fighting build if they think that, okay, well, let's just fight him. We can take the fight. We're strong enough at this point. And if they feel that they're not strong enough, Brood can just go for split pushing and try to delay the game even further.
Yeah, I really like that, and as you said, you just sometimes you've got to buy time for your team. Maybe they're just not doing as well as you wanted, and I really think it's valuable that they have both of these options here. Another charge is coming out onto the Brood Mama, and it looks like elsewhere we don't have too much action. We again have like six heroes chillaxing in mid. It is the party lane. But yeah, we're gonna have a charge. I don't know if they can kill with this one. Oh, but Queen of Pain, she's coming in. She's only level 5. She's gonna get these baby spiders. She's just gonna walk right up to the Broodmother and kill her, and we have a pause. This is climactic.
This is bad timing on the pause. If I knew Chinese, I would translate, but
Yes, that's really the problem here. Why don't you know Chinese?
I know.
Yeah.
Why wasn't I born in China and learned Chinese? I don't know.
Me too. Let's just put it that way. But we have a reconnect, and it looks like we should be back in business shortly. I don't think Broodmother has a way out of this. I'd love to see her attempt to deny herself, but I think the auto attacks coming out are way too
Queen
big.
of Pain doesn't
Yeah.
have
Oh, Queen of Pain's
enough of a
dead!
blink, so.
Yeah, and that's the only blink. The Searing Chains come out, and this is gonna be a double kill. Broodmother actually getting both of those. Monet TPing in time to get experience, so actually pretty nice for the Ember Spirit. You're always happy to accelerate your farm in that way.
Yeah, and now you can maybe send the Broodmother bottom, and Broodmother doesn't really care now with the web changes. I think he should be fine on webs to just TP bottom and go to that lane. We'll see what he decides to do.
Oh,
well, now he's going back top, it looks like.
Yeah, they have found A's just leeching experience off of these stacks. It's not the most glamorous job, but has an invis rune, has a lot of people around him. Is gonna actually get charged? Yeah. Spiritbreaker doesn't see that though, right? That he bashed someone? If they're invisible?
I don't know if it's supposed to, but I think you do see that sometimes, at least.
I don't know if he could tell.
Yeah, it's kind of like if you walk past an invis hero, you can tell. It kind of blocks you, but a lot of people won't notice it.
Like the famous Weehaw play. I don't know if you've seen that one yet.
I have not.
He had an illusion here, and he ran it back and forth. He just shift queued it to run back and forth, and it detected a smoke, because you know the hero was suddenly moving weirdly.
So actually really, really smart.
It was brilliant. It won them the game. It was... My mind was blown. Anyway, but in this game, not going to be so much. Monet actually up there with the Broodmother. I'm going to switch us over to net worth just because it's lies with the Queen of Pain looking like she has a million CS early in when, of course, it is just her using Scream. But again, what's up with all these heroes mid? I understand it's important that Viper doesn't fall behind or that the TA doesn't snowball, but I feel like having, you know, six heroes mid all the time just means you're being inefficient in other lanes.
Well, it's something we see a lot this patch, is people will just kind of focus mid, and it's mostly because your mid lane right now is becoming really important towards whatever, like, happens in your... or they might be going on bottom.
Yeah, but this is a really Todd kill to try and get. Like, unless she blinks poorly, you're not going to be able to get the snowball off on her, you know?
If you get chains, though, chains will stop blink.
Yes, they're going in for the snowball. They don't get the Searing Chains, but again, that's exactly the blink that they needed. Batrider goes down elsewhere, and this is a dead paparazzi. Nice sonic wave. Can they get some follow-up? A lot of people taking damage from the Tombstone. Searing Chains come out to stop Pretty Hua from doing more damage, and suddenly he is on the back lines. Do they have the damage? All remnants expended. Monet is in the danger zone now. Quap has bought back. Should have a screen. Spirit Breaker kills off the AA on the back lines. Ice Shield's not going to separate the two, and Monet is dead, as is Mr. Man, which is what I'm calling this fight. So doesn't get the TP out. Not quite worth it, I think, there, unfortunately.
It's okay. Broodmother got a tier 2 for it. You traded, I think, 2 for 3 with a buyback. And TA's farming this agent stack. So although it may not look the best, they're getting a lot of map control and they're getting a lot of stacks farmed off of this. So even though they may not trade well for kills, they're still trading well overall.
And with that, we're going to be seeing Templar Assassin getting her boots finished off. She's not snowballing. We've definitely seen Templar Assassins have a bit more game impact this early on, but she's helping put FTD at a firm lead over Team Fan this game, and she can keep on stacking up and taking these. It'll help her get her Deso maybe around 15 minutes if she keeps this up.
Yeah. She's pretty farmed. She's not doing great. Her last hits are really low for 10 minutes, honestly. She probably only had maybe 20-something last hits in lane, because she just got, like, 30 ancient creeps, but...
I mean, luckily, she got vipered, and we got a snowball on bottom. Remnant as well. Very aggressive Monet is with these remnants. I have to say, and Templar Assassin is not in a good spot. But they have the dust coming out. Refraction's only gonna... But she bashed her? No! She wished she was bashed to the high ground there. And now AA is coming in. The cold feet may proc if he's not careful. Instead, blinks away right into the waiting arms of a Tusk. And Ember Spirit's gonna get a Spirit Breaker kill. No extra follow-up for them. And these spiders... Oh, because you're pushing bottom now. She ran them all. Maybe even thinking of Roshan. I think getting more kills on the Ember Spirit always nice, but of course you would prefer not to lose your Templar Assassin for it.
Yeah, this Ember Spirit's getting really big. Yeah. He's 4-1 already at 10 minutes. He has a DD bottled. He's going to treads. I think he'll rush a Battle Fury. We'll see.
And of course,
no matter what he goes, he's pretty much set for the rest of the game. Once you get ahead like this, it's really hard to shut you down.
It's also something where it feels like Ember Spirit, he often trades levels for farm in a safe lane, but he's already level 8, only one level behind the Templar Assassin, only half a level behind the Viper. He's doing really well, and a lot of his damage output comes from having those levels.
Oh, they may go on mid.
Yeah, they're going again. Templar Assassin, her life is rough. She's dusted up. I don't see any way out. An Ice Blast gonna be coming in, though. They've got that up pretty early, all things considered. And another Searing Chains. I don't know if they have the damage. That guy might be able to... Oh, no. He does, in fact, shatter. I wasn't quite sure since it's a level 1 AA Blast. And now... Quap gonna be zoned away. That is still a very low level blink. She's actually maxing it now. We often see people put maybe 2 points in Shadow Strike, but she understands that in this game, if she's locked down, it's instant death.
Yeah, I think mostly you put 2 in Shadow Strike if you're in the mid lane, just because it's really good for harassing and zoning. And level 1 Shadow Strike's range is a little low when you're in the middle lane, but if you're going in the off lane or the safe lane, you definitely just want to put all your points into blink once you max your screams.
I now remember what I wanted to say before when I rambled. Ember Spirit has a lot of extra gold as well from the pressure Broodmother's putting around the map. This can't be discounted.
Oh, yeah.
So he's going to have a very forced Battle Fury. He's also, again, just like last game when it was played by ZMSJ, he is choosing to not go for the bots, and he will get up that Battle Fury. Maybe not a 16-minute Battle Fury, but it's going to be early.
He went for the more standard Treads build nowadays. Treads is really favored on the hero as it gives you a lot more mana pool, which you really need, and it helps you kind of stay in the fights a little longer.
And Templar Assassin doing something that's really surprising me. I said she was going Deso because that is the build I am used to. She has picked up a Blade of Alacrity, so potentially Manta, potentially Sand and Yasha. Their smoke's gonna break maybe a little bit too early. We've got the snowball coming in. Quap, of course, gonna blink away. That snowball does roll through one, and they are now all over the place. This, I don't know how this teamfight can go well for FTD. The lasso comes out. The ice blast does manage to hit on one, but Ember Spirit, he's the one caught out of position. He remnants into a tombstone, and this teamfight, it has fallen apart. The immediate TP's out, I think, the best thing they can do, but they want more, and I think they're going to get it. So at least 2 down and 2 pretty dang big kills. Tries to snowball to the creeps, but his own ice shards are blocking him out, and one more auto attack. Queen of Pain will get it with a scream. So, really unfortunate there for the lineup of FTD. I don't think they were expecting their smoke to be broken so early.
Yeah, but, I mean, luckily you have a Broodmother, so even if you lose fights like this, your Broodmother split push you mid, and this means that, if they decide that they want to force this tier 1 issue, Broodmother might be able to get a tier 2 in trade.
Yeah. And this lead that we can see that FTD has, this is pretty much tower gold and maybe that ancient stack, and then you can see the experience is actually in favor of FTD. This is something that happens commonly against teams that are pushing up. So, Orchid, close for Queen of Pain.
So right now they're grouping up top, I think. One thing to put out is that FTD did get a great ward down here, so they're gonna see this Batrider rotating up, and they're gonna make the recording adjustments after taking Roshan.
Yeah, I really like this early Roshan Broodmother, a build I haven't seen for a while. The Vladimir's first. It's maybe not as popular on the Broodmothers we've been seeing, and this immediate Yasha up on the Templar Assassin, I have to say, this is not what I was expecting. I feel like it does help you farm faster, but so does Adesso.
Well, I guess it's that maybe she felt that Deso is maybe a too expensive build-up, and it gives you a lot of damage, but maybe she wanted the move speed to help get away from Viper, to help get away from Tombstone, and not only that, but Yasha does give her attack speed to help kill the Tombstone, which Deso doesn't really help nowadays.
Yeah, our Viper also has an interesting build. Both the Viper and the AA have their Midases done. It's not uncommon for a Viper to pick up a Midas. It certainly helps him farm, but I think he's going for a Maelstrom and then a Mjolnir.
That would be... Oh, you're right. He has a Midas and another Gloves of Haste. So.
This is a build I've seen before. There are arguments over one Viper's ability to farm. That's why the Midas is there. But also, he's such a tanky hero that if you're forced to kill him, you already take a lot of damage from Corrosive Skin. Why not add to that with something like a Mjolnir? He may also just pick up the Maelstrom and keep that for a while he maybe builds a BKB, depending on what he thinks he needs. We're going to have a Lasso coming out, pulling him into a Tombstone, but A-Blast, it's going to hit 3. That's pretty nice. But Monet, their big damage source, is down, and now now the AA falls as well. Templar Assassin should be able to get one kill on the back lines, but they have picked up 3-1. And now Templar Assassin, she is out in no man's land, not where she wants to be. She has a haste rune, though. And at the same time, while we say Templar Assassin in a lot of trouble, her haste is expiring. We're going to be seeing a TP down bottom. They want to make the most of this Templar Assassin silenced up. The zombie's coming up to her. She doesn't have another refraction charge, and that is a 4-0. She does have Aegis, but I don't know if she can stand here and fight. Broodmother on her way, but of course without those webs, she moves very slowly, and Templar Assassin I don't think is in the right place to kill them all. Boots on strength, she gets one, she'll get two. I don't know if she can kill this Queen of Pain, but is Paparazzi in the wrong place, wrong time, gonna immediately TP out? What do they have to stop her? Nothing, and so she is going to be out and about. Well played there by the Queen of Pain. Templar Assassin did a good job of almost tying up that gank, making it more of a 3-4, but still really unfortunate that she had to lose her life there. And I think, unfortunately, the lasso and, of course, this ward doing way too much work.
Yeah, that was a really good fight by... Actually, I think FT took a really good fight there. They got a good lasso. They were fighting into an Aegis, and they came out on top. It's a risky play, but I think they feel that they need to make these risky plays, and they might kill this Brood now.
Yeah, she is very much illuminated, although the dust will wear off in like 2 shakes of a lamb's tail. It's not soon enough, and even if it did wear off, Spiritbreaker was coming in with more dust to help out the cause. Now, saving Grace for FTD, they're still ahead in the gold by a little bit, and they're not really super far behind or anything in the experience. I
think they're actually winning the game. I mean, when you're this close game-wise against the draft like this, which is Viper, Spiritbreaker, like all these heroes that just want to fight, and just push your towers and kind of force you to be where they want you to be, being even right now is a great way for them, because you have to imagine they are down. Well, they have... how many towers? They only haven't got the tier 2 mid off of... Oh, I was wrong then. They're further behind than I thought.
Yeah, they're behind, but at the same time, their lineup isn't about to fall off. And this Viper does have his Maelstrom. Once again, folks, this is our first foray into casting Chinese Dota. We've done C, we've done NA, we've done Europe. I'm not sure if this is just a popular item build for him. I'm not sure if the Templar Assassin is played differently in this region. But I've definitely seen some Chinese teams run the Deso build, so I'm a little bit confused. Because I feel like this... Yeah, okay, there's the Deso now.
He just wanted Yasha first to give him the move speed, I guess. It's an unusual build, but it's not bad per se.
Yeah, and it's certainly something where you may end up getting a Manta a bit later to deal with the Orchid.
Absolutely, and even if she doesn't, she can still build it into all of
us. Quap just blunked, but is his max level blink, and I don't know if they have enough to do it. Oh, they're popping up that medallion. They're not deciding Pretty Hua is the hero they want, and they're going to also take that Tombstone Bounty. 150 gold at this point in the game. Yum yum, as they like to say. Paparazzi, though, almost has her Aghanim Scepter, and so that pithy little kill not maybe going to do as much work as they want.
Yeah, she's getting close. She didn't go boots, which is surprising. Normally you see Quap pick up treads, but she's instead opting just to rush the Ags and the Orchid. I think it's going to be difficult, because if they don't hit their timing in the next 10 minutes, this game gets pretty much impossible. Ember Spirit is going to go Manta style first item, I think, and then go transition his way into a Battle Fury, but against a Quap with such an early Orchid, I think it's an okay build.
Yeah, it's certainly slowing his farm down, but I agree with you. You need it against the silence. He's getting picked off. It's really hard. There's a lasso as well, so I actually think one of his teammates needs to get him either a Lincoln's or a Lotus Orb. Either of those, I think, fantastic pickups, because of course the Lotus Orb does purge, but we have Templar Assassin caught out again right under a sentry. There's also dust, if I recall correctly. A-Blast gonna only hit the Undying, who they don't care about, and Templar Assassin actually gets a kill, unfortunately, after her death, so no experience there for her, but considering she was 4-man ganked, making the best out of a bad situation, considering she was chilling in her enemy's jungle, maybe not the position to be.
Yeah, absolutely not. I think he just needs to play safe. I mean, they're not in any rush to try to win this game. But does Lotus Orb purge lasso? I thought it did.
No, no, no. Oh, no, sorry. It doesn't purge lasso, but it can purge off. It's a normal dispel, so it gets rid of things. I think the only thing that purges lasso is a photic shield.
There's a couple. Any hard,
Yeah,
it's like
hard
there's,
dispels.
yeah, hard purge or whatever it is.
Yeah.
I can
Oh,
change
yeah,
it.
the naming convention in Dota is not consistent. Because, yes, they're called purges,
Yeah.
and then there's also, like, cold hard dispels, which are, like, the same thing. But, yeah, it gets rid of a couple things here, though. It doesn't get rid of the Viper Strike, of course, but I believe it can get rid of the poison attack slow. You can get rid of, I don't think you can get rid of sticky napalm, but, of course, you can get rid of stuff like the silence coming out of the
You
orchid.
can charge the Spirit Breaker from across the map.
Yeah, so that's actually one of the scary things about Lotus Orb that I haven't seen this interaction before in a professional game, but I think it's a really powerful thing that can happen. I think just because a lot of the professional players are really good about when they put up the Lotus Orb knowing about this interaction. Oh, they immediately dust. They do actually catch out the Brood Mother. She is going to be silenced up, but they are deep for the lineup of FT. And if they decide to go on this, which they are, Brood Mother, she's got company. Sonic Wave, it only hits on one because of that nice little shield. Brood Mother is dead, though. And now Templar Assassin, she is being dragged back. That is not going to save her, even though she managed to get off that second instance of the refractions. And without Brood Mother on the map, this is fantastic for FT. They don't have to worry
Yeah.
about the pushing.
I think they might even try to high ground here. Like, is this where they think that
They
they're
have to get through a
strongest?
tier 1 and a tier 2, so it's a bit
I mean, the
rough.
tier 1's down. If they can get through with the tier 2 in
Yeah.
maybe 20 seconds, well, it's conceivable that they could try to get high ground here.
Yeah. But on the Lotus Orb with Spirit Breaker, I think a lot of the professionals understand that you
Dire
could end up
structures
with one of
are
your
fortified.
carries in like an awful position because of the charge, and they just don't pop it on.
Dire's bottom
Well, you
tower
can still cancel it, so
attacking.
it's not,
Yeah. But
it's
even
just like your
sometimes if you
reactions to
move
use.
like two Dota units, I don't know, let's call this
Radiant's
two Dota
middle
units,
tower is
they can
under
be
attack.
really bad for your
Dire's
positioning,
bottom
you
tower
know?
has fallen.
Yeah, and I mean, if you get Lotus Orbed by a teammate and then you don't notice for maybe like a couple seconds,
Yeah.
then all of a sudden you're all the way out of the fight.
Suddenly can be painful.
And you were right on the Viper, he did go Maelstrom into S and Y, so
Yeah.
it's a more carry Viper build.
Not uncommon. It also could just be his way of saying, I'm gonna add to the wave clear for the broodlings. Not really what I was expecting, but it could be perhaps his, like, I want to help. And it looks like Broodmother's about to be ganked again. She also went the medallion build. They're gonna Batrider on her face. They ganked her without detection, unfortunately. I think they were hoping to make a guess on her hopping out of one of the webs at some point.
No, that's unfortunate. That's it's just do they have detection on the courier?
Yes,
Oh,
there's a
they do. They
gem
have a
coming on
gem.
the courier. So I think she came out a bit earlier than they were expecting, and they were hoping to get the gank on her.
Yeah, and Brood is going for BKB, so it will make split pushing a lot safer for her. She can still get lassoed and hit by a Spirit Breaker, but it means that they won't be able to burst her quite as quickly.
She's kind of starting to go for a hybrid fighting build, although I don't know whether I should call it hybrid since Vlad's definitely fits in there. I feel like the medallion definitely says, I want to kill heroes. Maybe she just wants to kill Roshan. But then now going for a BKB, yes, it makes pushing safer, but I think it's also another great fight item.
Yeah, it can be used for both. She's not committing herself to one with going maybe like Necrobook or even Desolator, which are kind of just, I'm gonna split push, I'm gonna do whatever I want, I'm gonna do Broodmother things. No. I'm surprised they aren't just going for Roshan here.
Yeah. Broodmother is scouting them out. There's going to be a lot of dead baby spiders burned to death
Double
in their
damage
home
empowers
of the
me.
spider webs. Let's talk Batrider. He's got Blink Dagger, Gem, Forestall, all of these very standard Batrider items. What do you go next? Are you making Lotus Orbs routine? Like what?
I would like to see a Ghost Scepter on him first. I feel like TA is doing a lot of damage to him during these fights, and if he had a Ghost Scepter just to mitigate some of this damage, he'd be a lot better off. Once you get Ghost Scepter, you can go Aghanim's, you can go Lincoln Sphere,
Yeah, I
you can
actually
go a lot
think
of different items.
Ags here is fantastic. I said Lotus Orb, but there's actually very little that Lotus Orb does for you against FTD's lineup. Like, ridiculously little. So I think that the Aghanim's, as you mentioned, is a great pickup. And Brood Mama, oh goodness, is Batrider gonna find her with that gem? Yes, he will. There's a charge. Roshan, maybe gonna even help in with the bashing. Deny yourself to Roshan. Do it, Brood Mother. Not quite able to get it, but pretty well. Borsh is
Oh.
killing him with great prejudice, but that's still a level 1 AA blast. So now what AA has to do is, in the next 30 seconds, guess exactly where the Undying's going, and it's going to be a hard task considering he is being earned up to full health.
TA's trying to split push here. Viper's TPing back, so they're gonna kind of get out of rush on. And all this ward is really cool by FTD.
Yeah, so they're able to get Templar Assassin out despite the charge. Tusk is still chillaxing up there. He's managed to pick up a Blink Dagger for himself, which is fantastic. Always something great for that hero. He can now decide whether he's going to be working on Guardian Greaves, which is a common pickup for that guy, and will also help them. You know, maybe he gets silenced by the co-op, suddenly doesn't have to worry about that.
Yeah, I really like this ward, though. It's like the Tinker ward, because you can use it to find it whenever Tinker TPs the trees, but it's going to be really nice for when Broodmother wants to split push his lane. She'll know when Batrider is coming through the trees to try to Blink Lasso.
Yeah, and it's something that they believe they changed in Reborn, making these ward spots a little bit more easy to see around the map.
Yeah, it used to be you would just randomly click around until you got it. It was really inconsistent.
Yes, that's Dota for you. Ember Spirit goes down, and it looks like Viper is going to be getting another. They managed to get the Cold Feet to proc, but where's the damage? Sonic Wave expended for the AA. I guess it's fine because you got Aghanim's, but that is not maybe what I was expecting. But they get the Tusk too with a Lasso, and suddenly FT not looking like they're letting their foot off the gas in the slightest.
Yeah, it's a lot of misplays, I think, by FTD. They have the two similar names. They're just playing a little sloppy. They're getting picked off alone, and then they don't really back quick enough. The Tusk was staying around to maybe try to save, and the AA was trying to sit around to maybe save. When you get in that situation, you just have to cut your losses and just back off.
Yeah. Queen of Pain also is working towards an Octarine core, so she is about to get even more liberal with that ult. And this is, I think, just a case of they don't have stuff to lock her down. Sometimes we see Queen of Pains, you know, maybe forced into BKBs or Lincolns. She's not feeling it. She doesn't even need real shoes. So
Roshan still is up. I really would like FTD to maybe try to smoke into it with either Broodmother and or TA and try to steal it that way. As if they don't get it off and FT does get this rush on, they'll hit their timing around 30 minutes and just high ground and win the game that way.
Yep.
Oh no.
We've got another charge and there's going to be another strike as well. Refraction charges are all burned out, so I don't see how Templar Assassin can survive this. Sonic Wave comes out as well. They at least catch DDR there with the AA Blast, but again, it's not quite enough, and AA is only level 10. Initially, I was actually quite impressed by AA's progress. Got a relatively early level 6, considering how you have to play the hero, and then also picked up a very early Midas, but it just feels like FTD hasn't been guessing right on a lot of these engagements, and hasn't really been able to make the work they need to happen.
Yeah, and they even have a better draft. They're just not really playing their draft how I would have expected. They're just trying to farm alone because they feel that, well, we need to be out farming them, otherwise we're gonna, they're going on Batrider maybe.
Yeah, they try to, but they're not gonna manage to make it latch, and they actually snowball back out, realizing that they've missed. They are getting a lot of damage down to on this tower. Templar Assassin was working on it with her Deso earlier, so well played there. Ember Spirit finally has up his Battle Fury. He actually never finished that Manta.
Oh, did he not? Okay. I think he should go back for the Manta. It's going to be important for making sure that Quap can't just burst you down right away. Queen of Pain does have Octarine now, so her ultimate is at 30-second cooldown. It means you can go on anyone every 30 seconds.
And they don't really have a good defense against that. I mean, it's pure damage. You have to get raw health to deal with it, but she can be liberal with it. She can use it to kill the waves for fun. This AA Blast is probably not going to hit anyone. Yeah, it actually clips the Queen of Pain with the debuff. But again, oh, it just hit level 2. So that's something. And Viper is just standing up here. ZMSJ, he doesn't care. He's got an Aegis. He's now going to walk on their racks. And this is feeling a bit like the point in game 1 where the GGs were called. No one's split pushing. This is actually only 3 heroes of FT standing up here.
The Batrider and the Spirit Breaker were able to pick off the Ember Spirit as he was trying to split push.
Yeah, we got a Sonic Wave casually coming out for the Creep Wave, and they might just return to working on the racks. Viper, he's back up in the base. Ice shells come out. A blink forwards now being punished for it. You have to snowball here, Orbo, or you die. They're managing to get off an A blast. Are they gonna be in it? They hit it onto the Viper. No, he didn't get hit by the debuff. He was just taking snowball damage. Broodmother's trying to go in there and fight, but with her BKB active, just walking away. And this could just be GG. It looks like everybody's falling on the lineup of FDD. They have nothing left in the tank. Batrite is finally here, getting ready to do something to Xion, and he goes down to a Sonic Wave, and there's a GG call. That's it for this set.
Oh, another 2-0.
Yeah. So, I think, one, I'm surprised. Chinese Dota, I think, used to be well known for longer games. These teams cleaning each other up pretty short, in short fashion.
Yeah. I think Team FT just out-executed. They played really well. They did what they had to do. They had good smoke ganks. They had good rotations. It was just a really good display of Dota.
Yeah. And with that, folks, that'll be it for this match. We'll be going into the next set whenever that's ready. Once again, I'm Llama Down Under. You can see my handle on the screen. And we've got Noble Wings with a Z or Z joining us. You can also see his Twitter handle. Please show him some love. We'll be headed right into the next set. And we are doing Star Ladder, Dota. We are doing the Chinese scene. So I hope you're all enjoying. We would always love feedback on how to get better. So please feel free to throw that our way on what we can do to improve this cast for you. And we hope to see you after some words from the sponsors. So peace out, folks, and have a good one before the next game starts.